she was gracious enough to agree to give the talk this time. So Tanushree Chaudhary, she did her master's from Anna University in Material Science and then graduated with a PhD from the Materials Research Center at IISc Bangalore in 2014. Post that, she worked with Professor Joanne Redwing as an assistant research professor at Pennsylvania State University. And the research interests are things that she's going to also talk about today, which is understanding and controlling MOCVD growth of 2D materials for electronic and optoelectronic applications, as well as designing tools for in situ or control environment study of layered materials. So she's with us at IIT Bombay since this May. And very happy to have her and listen to her. So stage is yours then. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Jaya. I think I should ask you to write my bio. You've done a better job of it than I do. So thank you so much. Thanks a lot for this opportunity. And thank you all of you for being here. So hopefully it's going to be a useful whatever number of minutes we're here together. Can you guys all see the screen? Can you see the laser pointer? Am I audible? Is all that okay?
Yes, all good.
All right. So if that is it, then let's get started. All right. So today I will talk about controlling epitaxial growth of wafer scale at TMDs by MOCVD. And as what I will focus on will be these factors. We'll talk about epitaxial growth on a wafer scale, and we're talking about how do we control it. But before we get into those details, I wanted to mention, as Jaya said as well, that I joined in May, and most of the work that I'm showing right now is what I've done as a part of Penn State. And I'll tell you a little more about the organization towards the end of the talk. But before that, let's get started with the talk today. And the first question is, of course, why transition metal dichalcogenides? Now, the interest in transition metal dichalcogenide starts actually from graphene, which is a layered metal or a semi-metal, as you know. Very interesting properties, high mobilities, great mechanical strength. And that kind of opened up the doorway for other layered materials, which had a wide range of electronic properties. So you have insulators, you also have semiconductors, like glass phosphorus, MOS2. And what we had, what I particularly focused on was the transition metal dichalcogenides. Now, what is unique about these materials is inherent in the crystal structure itself. So if you look at the bulk crystal, you have very strong covalent bonds within the layer. This is the black atoms are the metal, and the yellow ones are the chalcogen, and there is a covalent bond present in the layer itself. But if you go away from the layer, these layers are held together by very weak van der Waals forces, which means that these layers can now be separated to form monolayer and fewer layer films, which have very interesting properties. So if you talk about just the TMDs itself, they have layer-dependent properties. So here is an example of MOS2, which transitions from an indirect band gap in the bulk to a direct band gap material as you reduce the number of layers and take it down to one layer. And that is also evident by the PL response of these materials, which becomes very strong and prominent when only a single layer is present. In addition to that, when you consider just the monolayer, there is a lack of inversion, which breaks the symmetry at the K prime and K minus power points of the Brillouin zone. And these points now couple differently with optical excitation. What I mean by that is that the K plus power valley couples with the right-hand polarized light, whereas the K minus valley couples with the left-hand polarized light. In addition to that, given that there are transition metals present in these films or in these materials, there's also a spin orbital coupling present, which splits the valence band. And that now allows you to create charges of a particular spin, which can create a situation where both the spin and the valley are coupled together. And you can now use one to produce a spin of a particular kind. Now, as these materials, as I said, have van der Waals interaction, we could consider heterostructures of these materials where we combine these materials without taking into account the lattice mismatching that is necessary, usually for typical 3D materials. So here is an example where you're taking them as just Legos and you're placing it on top of each other. And this is something that could be used for creating an all 2D electronic device itself. Now, the interest in heterostructures is because the heterostructures now exhibit properties that are different from the monolayers or the bilayers of these materials. One example is when we combine tungsten selenide and moly-selenide. Here, electron hole pairs are generated, which are separated by the layers itself, which increases the life of these excitons. And that can have properties or useful properties in terms of photovoltaics when you want to separate the charges out. Another field that is gaining interest is that of twistronics, where you are trying to control the twist between the layers. So here is an example where they had a monolayer of MOS2, and then they're placing another layer of MOS2 while controlling the twist angle. And what is observed out here is, depending upon the angle that you have, you get a different response in the optical properties. And this is something that can be used for now tuning the properties or optoelectronic properties of these materials. So given these intriguing properties and the physics that you can have from these materials, there are multiple applications for which they have been already investigated. For example, there are thin film photovoltaics, you have chemical and biosensors. There are also diodes and transistors made out of these heterostructures. Their mechanical strength makes them ideal for investigation for flexible electronics. And now there's a lot of work that is going on for integrating these 2D materials with silicon CMOS technology. And there are some other emerging applications, for example, for single photon emitters. In this particular case, tungsten selenide was irradiated with a laser beam to introduce defects. And these certain defects produce very, very sharp peaks, which correspond to single photon emitters. In addition to that, as I mentioned before, you have optical coupling with the spin of current or spin of electrons that can be generated in the TMD. So here is a TMD layer, which is now being excited via left-hand polarized light. And the charges which are generated here are being transferred onto a graphene layer, which can be used for making spintronic devices. Now, most of these materials or these applications have been shown for monolayers. The question, of course, is how do we actually get these monolayers? The majority of the work which has shown these novel properties has been focused on using bulk materials and exfoliating these bulk materials to form monolayers. This is what was done for graphene. It has been done successfully for many of these TMDs, again, because of the van der Waals attraction that's present between the layers. So here is a scotch tape. They just use this process to reduce it down to a single layer of graphene or of MOS2, and now you can make devices on it. The best quality material so far still happens to be the bulk crystals, and that is where most of these properties have been investigated. But these sizes of these flakes are limited to around a few microns, which is not ideal if in case you want to have a material that can be integrated with any industrial application. So, of course, many other efforts have been made to grow these monolayers, one of which is shown out here, which is the powder vapor transport or powder chemical vapor deposition. In this particular case, you have the powder, that is the moly oxide powder, and the sulfur powder sitting inside the reactor, and this is your substrate. And when the growth happens, you can find these triangles that you see out here. These are the moly sulfide or tungsten sulfide domains, depending upon the precursor chosen. And usually in this process, you get a lot of variation in the morphology, which is again not ideal if you want to get a large area growth. But however, this process has been tweaked quite a bit by changing how the growth parameter or the flow rates would be, so that you can now grow up to 4-inch wafers. The one disadvantage with this process is that if you want to make pristine heterostructures, the fact that your precursors are sitting inside the reactor itself, it makes it very difficult to change the precursors out and to produce or introduce that flexibility, which is what brings us to another growth method, which is the metal organic chemical vapor deposition. And this was a process, I'll tell you a little more about the process itself, but here what was done is you have these precursors which are being introduced. These precursors are kept external to the system, they react on the substrate and they're able to form a film. In this case, they were able to grow up to 4 inches on fused silica. Now, using this process, which was a hot wall system, and I'll tell you what the difference is as well in some time, what we find is you get a coalesced film in around 26 hours, which is a pretty long time for the formation of just one monolayer. In addition to that, they also found the presence of high angle grain boundaries. So out here, this is a colored dark field TM image, where each of these colors corresponds to a particular angle in the diffraction ring that is being created. So the objective that we had in mind was that we wanted to grow large area, single crystal TMD monolayers and heterostructures, which would be needed to advance device technologies. But before I get into it, I wanted to talk a little bit about the CVD or the MOCVD equipment basics. So this is what a typical system would look like. These are the different components. So first of all, you have precursors, which can be solid or liquid. And this could be the metal source, which is placed outside the reaction chamber. And you can control the temperature and bubbler precisely so that you can control the precursor flux. Then you have hydrides, which are the chalcogen sources, like silane, ammonia, but you have H2SE and H2S as well, which can be used as the other. So if you have TMDs, you have a transition metal, and you have the chalcogenide. So you're basically choosing a hydride for the chalcogenide and a metal using these precursors. A major component of such a system is the run vent manifold, which allows us to establish steady state gas flows and switching. And the heart of the system is the reaction chamber, where you are able to do the reactions. Now, typically, what we have used in our system in our studies, a cold wall system, which is where your substrate is heated up specifically and the rest of the reactor is not. But you can also have a situation where the entire reactor is heated up, which is what is known as the hot wall system. And finally, for maintaining the pressure, you have a throttle valve and a pressure controller so that you can maintain the pressure from millitorr to atmospheric pressure. So there's a huge range of pressure that we work at. Now, given the precursors that we use, some things to keep in mind as these are can be highly toxic, it can be highly pyrophoric. So it is very important that the handling of this is taken into account. So usually these precursors and the systems are kept in a ventilated enclosure. You have toxic gas and flame detectors. You want to make sure that there is no way they can be exposed to the people who are using it. But this would be what the basic setup for any CVD system would be. So in our case, what we had are, again, chemical cold wall reactors. We used typically two different systems which were equipped to grow up to 2-inch wafers. Here is a horizontal system where you have a graphite susceptor which couples with the induction coils outside. And then you have the Raman and the other one, which is the vertical reactor. This is actually a part of a multi-module system where out here, this animation shows how the robotic arm transfers the sample into the growth chamber. And the same arm can then transfer it into an attached glove box and where we can use it to analyze the sample using Raman and PL. Now, both of these reactors have been made in such a way that we can seal the samples either in a glove box or do analysis without exposure to the ambient, because most of these calculations that we're making are also sensitive, air sensitive and moisture sensitive. So we would like to at least try and minimize the damage. Now, in this particular system, we use these precursors, tungsten hexacarbonyl, moly hexacarbonyl. In case of this chalcogens, however, we do have a couple of choices. And this is the first question that we actually had to answer. Which is the chalcogen that we want to use and how do we decide it? Now, based on just literature, it was difficult to make this decision because there is a whole plethora of literature which seems to sway one way or the other, but there wasn't anything conclusive. So which brought us to the first problem that we dealt with, and which was, what is the role of the chalcogen precursor? So in this particular case of tungsten sulfide, what we have is, this is the AFM morphology obtained for diethyl sulfide, and this is what we get for hydrogen sulfide. And as you can see, the domain sizes are very limited in the case of diethyl sulfide. In addition to that, you also see a prominent presence of carbon peak when you use diethyl sulfide as a precursor. When we look at the optoelectronic response, or just the photoluminescence, what we find is it has a strong photoluminescence for hydrogen sulfide, which is again quenched in case of diethyl sulfide. In addition to that, the X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy, which tells you about the chemical state of the material, shows that you have a more complicated stoichiometry when you're using diethyl sulfide. So hydrogen sulfide is beneficial for getting the stoichiometry desired. So the carbon that we are forming is actually detrimental to the domain size, the stoichiometry, and the optical properties. Similar results were also obtained for tungsten diselenide. Here we use dimethyl selenide, and again, the presence of carbon is there, and we have a limited growth of the carbon layer. But the same, you don't see the presence of carbon and also a continuous film when hydrogen selenide is used. And what we observe in this particular case is that you form a layer of carbon on the sapphire, and that interferes with the lateral growth of tungsten sulfide. So the conclusion from both of this was, of course, that hydride-based chalcogens would promote the formation of phase pure TMDs. Now, in case of MOCVD systems or in case of CVD itself, the choice of precursor becomes extremely important because that can have significant impact on the growth that we do. So how do we know what kind of temperature or pressure regimes do we go for to get a phase pure material? So one of the ways in which this can be informed or this can be evaluated is using thermodynamic calculations. So out here, for example, we have tungsten hexacarbonyl, which reacts with diethyl sulfide and hydrogen sulfide in a hydrogen ambient. And if it does react, it can form these many condensed phases and these many gaseous phases. So this thermodynamic calculation depends on finding the minimum Gibbs free energy subject to the mass balance constraints. And by that, what I mean is, say for example, we start out with tungsten hexacarbonyl and hydrogen sulfide and hydrogen in this ratio. It means that we're starting out with 1 mole of tungsten, 6 moles of oxygen, 6 moles of carbon, and whatever number of moles of hydrogen and sulfur. So when this reacts, it could ideally form any of these species containing tungsten. But when you add up all of those species containing tungsten, the number of moles of tungsten should still add up to 1. So using this mass balance, when you're trying to minimize the Gibbs free energy, it tells you what kind of compounds can form and in what amounts. And that allows you to form phase diagrams, one of which is given out here. So here we show the most probable or the chemicals that would form in the significant amount. And when there is DES used as a precursor, you find that you form not only tungsten sulfide, you also form solid carbon. And above a particular temperature, we would also get tungsten carbide. But in case of hydrogen sulfide, the only solid that's formed is tungsten sulfide, which is what we would ideally want. So using these thermodynamic calculations, it's actually possible to take any kind of precursor and predict what kind of a growth zone we should aim for so that we can get the phase pure material. So after having decided that we wanted to get hydrogen sulfide or the hydrides for getting phase pure material, the next question is, of course, how do we make a single crystalline film which would have the desired properties? So let's get into that now. So the requirements or challenges that you would have is, here we're talking about two very dissimilar elements, the transition metals, which have very, very high melting points, hence very low diffusivities, and you have chalcogens, which have very high vapor pressures. Which means that if I want sufficient surface diffusivity, then I need to have growth temperatures above 700 degrees C. Similarly, but at these temperatures, you're also going to have that the selenium and sulfur would not really want to stick to the surface because of its vapor pressure. So we also now have to create situations where we have very high chalcogen to metal ratios. So if you satisfy this condition, you can get the transition metal and your vapor and your chalcogen to coexist so that you can get the material you want. But we want a single crystalline film. So for that, we now need to control the density and the orientation of the initial nuclei. And then we have to control the growth conditions such that the lateral growth is going to be promoted. So we want an epitaxial orientation, which finally should coalesce to form a monolayer film. So to obtain an epitaxial orientation, we look for substrates. That's typically what is done for 3D material growth as well. And it seems to work very well for these Wonderwall materials as well. So here are some materials whose lattice parameter is given and the lattice mismatch with respect to MOS2 is also given. So if you take an example of alpha alumina, it has a very large match and mismatch where you do 1:1 matching between MOS2 and alumina itself. But the MOS2 and 0001 plane of alpha alumina has a commensurate lattice matching, which is considered called domain epitaxy. So here you can take 3 unit cells of MOS2 and align it with 2 unit cells of alpha alumina, and you find that the lattice mismatch now reduces. And the first evidence that alpha alumina could actually act as an epitaxial or a substrate for epitaxial growth of MOS2 was actually seen in this particular manuscript, where we could find for the first time monolayer MOS2 was grown, which was aligned. But the problem is that usually when this growth happens on alumina, you find that there can be two different possible orientations of this MOS2, because both of these orientations are energetically equivalent for sapphire itself. But this causes a problem. So for example, if you take an nuclei which is oriented in the top direction and the other one that is oriented in the opposite direction, if these two come together and coalesce, then they form an inversion domain boundary, which is metallic, and that is non-ideal for a semiconductor. But in the other case, if both of these domains are oriented in the same direction, they should ideally stitch together to form a perfect crystal. And this is what we're trying to do. So we have to create conditions for the transition metal and the chalcogenide to coexist. We have to create conditions so that we form nuclei which can orient in the same direction. And we have to make sure that the monolayers keep growing out while suppressing the additional formation of bilayers and trilayers. So the first thing that we did was we developed a process, a three-step process for making tungsten selenide monolayers. So this process is schematically shown out here, and it is carried out in a constant flow of hydrogen selenide. So here we have the first step is to introduce a high flow of tungsten hexacarbonyl. At the end of which, which is just 30 seconds, you have these large particulates, and if you increase the magnification, you find 50 nanometer droplets of tungsten-rich particles present on the sample. In the next step, the tungsten hexacarbonyl source is removed, and these nuclei are allowed to anneal in the presence of hydrogen selenide, so as to promote surface diffusion. So these nuclei, they diffuse, they come together, they coalesce, and they start forming these triangular domains, which are now oriented with respect to the substrate. And finally, in the lateral growth stage, we reintroduce the tungsten hexacarbonyl, but at a lower partial pressure, so that we can enable that these existing nuclei can grow out. And we get a coalesced film in about 45 minutes. So this is a monolayer of tungsten selenide. Here you do see the presence of bilayers and trilayers. Now, as I mentioned, we are trying to get monolayers. Now, I will talk about how we can suppress these bilayers and trilayers in some time. The advantage of this process is not just that we can make a monolayer, a coalesced film in 45 minutes, which is considerably lesser than 26 hours, which I talked about before, but it also allows us to separate these processes out. And this lets us study the mechanism of how this growth would happen. So for example, the ripening stage actually allowed us to measure the diffusivity of these tungsten-rich particles on sapphire. But if you consider just the lateral growth stage itself, so for out here, what was done is the nucleation and the ripening were kept constant, and the lateral growth basically was done for different periods of time. Just for reference, the ones that are black out here is the tungsten selenide domain, and these areas are sapphire. And as it gets darker, these are for thicker layers of tungsten selenide. So as you keep increasing the growth time, you find that the coverage of the tungsten selenide increases, right? And so if you plot it, we find that the domain size increases, the coverage is around 100% around 45 minutes, which is less than 1 hour. But we also start seeing the formation of bilayers. And this bilayer increases after about 50% monolayer coverage. But having this particular way of studying this films, what we can also find out is the orientation of these domains. And what we find is that these two orientations, which are opposite to each other, are equally prevalent because they are equivalent with respect to the sapphire substrate underneath it. Now, as I mentioned before, this is not an ideal situation, right? Because you don't want there to be anti-phase domain boundaries, but I'll get into that in some time. Now, once we have this film, we found that just a normal XRD machine that we have in our departments actually can give you is a very powerful method of finding out the epitaxial relation between the film that we make and the substrate, which is shown out here. So if in case you take the normal XRD and you take the conventional Bragg-Brentano geometry for a 2D monolayer, what you would expect is this would be the thickness of the layer, which is too thin. Hence, you would expect a broad peak for a tungsten selenide, which is what we observe out here. But if in case we do an in-plane XRD, where we are taking the plane of diffraction very close to the sample, such that now this becomes the thickness that you're analyzing, you are now able to get very sharp peaks from the tungsten selenide, and that can be used for finding out the epitaxial relation between tungsten selenide and sapphire. So this was a nice way for us to find out that we have an epitaxial film, and we can also find out the in-plane rotation that might be present in the film itself. But the one thing that XRD is unable to give is it cannot distinguish between the inversion domains. But it still gives you a nice way of analyzing what your epitaxial relations are. And this is something that we have used extensively for our films, just to know what kind of material we are forming during the growth. Now, as I mentioned before, we are able to make these films which have two different orientations, but we can get the coalescence in about 30 minutes. What we found is that if in the lateral growth, we increase our temperatures to 1000 degrees C, and we also increase our hydrogen selenide flow, then we now have created a condition where one of the orientation is more preferred than the other. And when we allow this growth to continue for a longer period of time, you find that you now start leaving behind negative space, which is in the opposite direction, which means this particular orientation is being maintained. So just by modulating the fluxes and the temperature of growth, we are now able to change how the substrate orients the films. The question is, of course, why does it do so? So in literature, it has been seen that you can have steps on sapphire, like for example here, these steps usually help in orienting at the nucleation sites. And this is typical for any kind of material growth, that steps are the point where nucleation is easier to happen. But in our case also, we do have a sapphire film which has these steps present, and this is miscut 0.2 degrees towards the end plane. But this is what a typical sapphire substrate looks like. And we thought maybe in our case also the same thing is happening, and that is the reason why it seems to work. However, what we find is that when we reduce our nucleation density or reduce our tungsten flux to a great extent, we can now find where the nuclei are actually sitting, and they all seem to be trapped at the edges of these terraces. If you allow it to grow, most of these nuclei grow into the terrace. So what we think is happening is that when we're exposing the sapphire to the precursors, it forms these tungsten-rich particles which gets trapped at the terrace edges, and these, when they grow out, grow into the terrace. Just to see whether it really cracks or not, what we did is found some statistical numbers on the nuclei which was concentrated on the terrace edges and the ones which were at the terrace centers. And what we find is that wherever the nuclei were centered around the terrace edge, there's a predominance of one particular orientation with respect to the other, which clearly shows that even though sapphire itself does not have a means of breaking the symmetry, but the presence of steps definitely breaks the symmetry or breaks the distribution between which orientation is preferred. And this could be used for getting single orientation films. Now we use the same process for the synthesis of tungsten sulfide. So here is a photograph of a 2-inch wafer, and these are AFM images from different segments. And out here, what you see as bright piece-like parts are actually bilayer regions. Again, I will come to how we address the bilayer concentration. With the AFM, we were able to find out that the layer thickness was around 0.92. That corresponds to the thickness of the sapphire, of the tungsten sulfide and the van der Waals gap that you have. And we also use in-plane XRD to establish the epitaxial relation between these films. And the full-width half maxima out here, as I said, shows the very low rotational misfits present in the film itself, which is good news for us. Now the question is, what happens to these films, or how do we know what the optical properties are? So for that, we looked a little more in details at just mapping these films on sapphire using PL. And here what we get is at room temperature, this wafer was split up into a grid, and at each point PL mappers or PL spectra was taken. And you can now deconvolute it to find out the excitonic position and the negative trion position. And we can plot the excitonic peak position and the intensity. The fact that the positions are not very far apart from each other is an indication that you have a monolayer film or close to a monolayer film. But when you look at the intensity, it gets more intense towards the edges. And this tracks with the fact that the density of bilayers actually also falls off towards the edge of the film. In addition, we also use Raman spectra to add these points to find out what the number of layers would be, because it's important to know what the properties are across the entire film. So here what we find is, this is a typical Raman spectra at 532 nanometer for tungsten sulfide, and you have different modes of vibrations possible. So the most prominent modes is the E2G, which is out of plane vibration of these atoms, and then you have the A1G, which is the in plane. So depending upon the separation between these two, you can now determine what kind or what number of layers you have present in your material. And so we do a similar map, and we find that the number of layers is, again, close to one, which is what gives us the uniformity across the wafer. But these are coalesced films, and we know nothing about the microstructure, which is something that we now have to think about. So here is a method that we use for finding out the microstructure of these monolayers. These tungsten sulfide was removed from sapphire using wet transfer method and transferred onto a TEM grid. And here is a bright field TEM image where you see the contrast because of the layer number. So the two number bilayer films appear to be darker than a monolayer area. But if you take, this is a single selected area diffraction pattern. And if you take a diffracted beam and from the dark field image, you now see additional features in the monolayer region. So what was done in this particular case is Daniel Sai and Naseem, they worked pretty hard to get these images across multiple spots, so that at least we would look at 5 micron by 5 micron, which is obviously not as large as the entire 2-inch wafer, but gives us a little more information. And here there are a couple of things that features that are clear and I want to point out. Some of them are the tears present, which are happening because of the transfer. Then you have the bilayers present. You also have these pin holes, which are these triangular holes present, which we think are the vestiges of the growth itself. But the rest of the region, this is an entire monolayer region, but you can see a lot of gray contrast. There's darker and lighter gray contrast. Question is, why does this happen? Now, in case of transition metal dichalcogenides, there are two different phases that are possible. And this is the top view of the 2H and the 1T phase. So the difference is how the sulfur is placed with respect to each other. So ideally, if you take a diffraction or dark field image, this would appear to be lighter and this would appear to be darker, or vice versa, depending on which one you, which diffraction spot you're picking. Now here, what this means, so we thought that maybe we're getting the contrast because of this, but looking at XPS Raman spectra, which does distinguish between the 2H and 1T phase, we found that this is not the case. We have a 2H film, but we still get a contrast in out here in the dark field image. So in order to find out what this was because of, a little more detailed study was done, and we literally, the entire grain boundary was mapped out. And what we find is there are two different kind of grain boundaries separating these regions. One of them is a type A, where you have a compression of the lattice right here. And the type B is a mixture of 6 tungsten and 4 tungsten grains. But the thing that's most important, or the most significant observation, was that when you look at the orientation of the domains across this line defect, you find that both these regions are oriented the same direction. There is a slice misalignment, subatomic misalignment of these coalescing domains, which is resulting in the line defect. But these are still oriented in the same orientation, which means that we are getting close to a single crystalline film. So when we looked a little more at what would happen with the different growth conditions, here is a couple of observations. One is, when we are at a lower growth rate, we do form 5 to 10% bilayers, and we have a monolayer which has a large density of these line defects. But in the case of increasing the growth rate, we are now able to suppress the bilayer density, and we also see a subsequent decrease in the density of these line defects, which means this would be the way to go forward to reduce the bilayers and also reduce the number of line defects which are present in the film. So a similar process was employed for different materials. So we have tungsten selenide, tungsten sulfide, and molyselenide, all of which are epitaxial with respect to sapphire. And we have considerable success in controlling the bilayers. We do see that for tungsten selenide, we have a larger bilayer density than we get for the sulfides. And that may be because of the fact that selenium would have more adsorption on the surface, just because its vapor pressure is lower than that of sulfur. But we are trying to develop, or this work for developing MOS2 is still underway. Now, the structural properties of these films look great, but as I mentioned, we need to know a little more about the defects present in this film. And one of the ways to do it, or find out, is photoluminescence. So in this particular case, temperature-dependent photoluminescence was carried out. And here what we find is, at room temperature, you have an 82 millicuron volt peak, full width half maximum, which is pretty large, on sapphire. And we take a map of this across 10 cross 10, and here we find a lot of variation in the position. But the moment we transfer this film off the sapphire onto SiO2, we now have we now find that our full width half maximum reduces at room temperature itself. But as you keep reducing the temperature, you also see a difference in the spectra. So initially it was oxytonic peak that would dominate, but because of the transfer process, it gets doped, and now you have a trion contribution. So when we plot just the excitonic peak, we find that this variation in position is now minimized. And that is, we attribute this to the fact that there are growth-related stresses present just because of the cooling down process itself, which get released when we are transferring the film onto an SiO2 substrate. Now at 80 Kelvin, carrying out power-dependent study is a wonderful method of figuring out what kind of contributions are really present in your PL spectra. So you can have excitons, trions, bi-excitons. You can also have defect-bound peaks, and this is what we're most interested in. So at 80 Kelvin, what we find is that we have very minimal defect-bound peaks. And in addition to that, we get a narrow and uniform PL emission at 80 Kelvin without any H-beam encapsulation. And these full-width half-maximas are comparable to those of the exfoliated flakes. So as I mentioned before, the exfoliated flakes are still the gold standard. So we are trying to get at least close to that, and then hopefully surpass it. So we are at least getting closer to these exfoliated flakes. So when we look at the field effect devices of these materials, and the comparison was made between the MOCVD monolayer that we made and the exfoliated flakes, What we have here is that the mobility and the substantial slopes are pretty similar for both of these materials, and that is promising. So having made three different materials, we also made a comparison between the field effect properties of these materials itself. And what we find is that MOS2 so far has shown the most promising material property. The tungsten sulfide shows properties similar to that of what has been reported by other groups for CVD grown films, but the tungsten sulfide somehow shows the lowest currents, and the properties are absolutely crap. That is the technical word for it. And because, and I think it's because of the fact that the transfer process is destroying the tungsten selenide itself, and that causes a lot of problems that we need to solve in order to use the tungsten selenide for any application that we might have. So using these materials, what we've been able to do are work with them to see if we could use integrate them into devices. And these are some of the devices as photo detectors, a collision detector, or even as quantum emitters, where our collaborators were able to work with us to use these materials to see what we can do with them. So I would like to summarize with this that MOCVD is definitely a promising approach for producing vapor scale single crystals. And that happens when you're able to control the nucleation density and figure out how to control the lateral growth while imposing a symmetry or an orientation on the nuclei by the substrate that you use. And using this, the optical and transport properties that we found are at least approaching those of the exfoliate flakes, which means at least we're on the right track and we have a lot more to do, no doubt. We're still working on, or there is still work going on the growth of alloys and metrostructures. So this is the group that I worked with. It's called the 2D Crystal Consortium. It's a national user facility, which was focused on advancing the synthesis of 2D chalcogenides. And they have different processes like theory and simulation, bulk growth, and thin films and in situ characterization, so that they could make considerable, or the approach was how do we get good quality 2D materials or 2D chalcogenide materials. And of course, I need to acknowledge the group that I worked with. This is the entire group in the pandemic, all virtual meetings, but a wonderful gang of people to work with. This is Professor Joan Redwing, the professor in charge for the 2D Crystal Consortium. And this work wouldn't have been possible without the collaborators and the funding that we got from NSF. So I would like to thank you for your attention. And if you have any questions, please feel free.
Guru, will you go or should I?
Yeah, you go ahead.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Tanu, for a wonderful presentation, as always. I will just get, sort out if there are people raising their hands. But if not, please feel free to unmute yourself and ask your questions. I think there was something in the chat box that...
Yeah, Aditya Narayan Pandey, what are these domains? Electrical, magnetic, structural, why triangular shape growth of domains?
Right, so these domains are structural. We're talking about, so let me go back. And second. Okay, let's go for this. So typically these, ideally you can modulate these. If you look at these materials, there is a particular shape that is going to be most stable. So you can have hexagonal shapes, but then given that the conditions under which we grow them are so chalcogen rich, that this is the reason why the termination that grows out is the selenium terminated surfaces, and those form a triangular domain. So these are entirely triangular because of just the kinetics of how the edges grow out and how we control the fluxes.
Anyone else with questions?
Yeah, I had a question. Sure. So when you have these steps, generally we think that the atoms will go to the kink. But why does it go to the edge and start growing onto the terrace?
That is a wonderful question. So we are just trying to figure out why exactly would that be the case. And what we have are some recent experiments where we see that I think it's got to do with, so we're trying to do some modeling to figure out what exactly would happen. So depending upon what the termination of the edge is, it appears that the precursor that we form that wants to stick to the top of the terrace and not the bottom. And the precursor that we are forming is partly because of the gas phase reactions that are happening. So it's not tungsten hexacarbonyl and hydrogen separate, but then it's supposed to be some tungsten, selenium, or complex Z forms. And that seems to prefer the terrace edges under the growth conditions that we have. We actually tend to confirm whether that simulation is actually correct or not, but that is what I think is different in this particular case.
Thanks, Tanisha.
Ramani?
I was just listening to you, which is quite fascinating. Now, there are a few questions. I hope you don't mind a series of questions. Yeah? It's just that I want to learn a bit of a thing here. Now, the question is, this is a, you said 2-inch substrate, right? What is the, characterization that you have done on the substrate itself? What levels of steps and things that you have? And did you try and do, in the silicon, they use planarization. Okay. Mm-hmm. So something like that, did you try? Or, in a little bit more sophisticated way, you can actually put it in an FIB and, polish the substrate mm-hmm. itself. So any one of these experiments, were they tried? And did you have any substrate rotation that was done while you were depositing, or what was the geometry for the reactor where the input gas stream was, put in? So how was the geometry of the reactor? So these were some things that were occurring to me. Were all these things tried and then you have, arrived at this? Something like that.
Right. Okay. So the first is the substrate itself. So we use the samples and substrates as received. They are supposed to have gone through some CMP polishing. The characterization that we do with any of these substrates is that we looked at AFM, which is the bare minimum, at different locations just to see what kind of angles we would get or what the steps looked like. And they look pretty uniform across the entire wafer. Now, given the fact that these steps are working out to be so beneficial or they have such an impact on how the growth happens, we are looking right now. There is work going on changing the step orientation by using a different polishing technique itself. So otherwise, the steps, the thing that we used was just as received. And the only thing that we did was just AFM at different locations just to confirm.
The other corresponding question was, you can also use, this is heteroepitaxy, right? It doesn't matter. The lattice parameter of the substrate doesn't matter. So why not go with the most available substrate, silicon? You have chosen only L2O3. L2O3 is a little bit more problematic. And if you say you want oxides because of the Burgess vector, so you want the defects to be much lower in terms of density, then why not use even a gadolinium garnet or garnet kind of even higher lattice parameter oxides, Right. So these were something that was, just occurring to me.
Right. So one of the reasons for using sapphire was because it's chemically the most stable that we find in these conditions. For example, silicon itself is something that reacts quite violently with with hydrogen selenide and hydrogen sulfide. To the extent that when we have carried out any reactions without thinking about what could happen, we have had a situation where it was actually became a problem to open up the reactor to take the sample out. So silicon is something that would be a no-no just because it's more reactive with hydrogen selenide.
Okay, that point is taken. Exactly. And then in which case you could try so many other oxides,
Yeah, absolutely. So the reason for starting out with it partly was that this is something that we have, we wanted something that was stable, but no doubt you can investigate many other oxides. And right now, for example, there is work going on in just integrating it with gallium nitride. But the reason for choosing it was partly availability and also availability for us and also the stability of the material, for which we thought that aluminum oxide just worked better in terms of, if you expose aluminum oxide to hydrogen selenide under these conditions, nothing was happening to it per se. So we thought that the substrate would be kind of stable to the entire process. But yes, there could be other options as well. As long as they are stable in the reaction kinetic or the reaction, the chemistry that we're choosing, I think, yes, it's worth it to look at other options as well.
Yeah, thanks.
Preeta, you have a question?
Hi, Tanushree. This is way, maybe way below my length scale of understanding, but much smaller length scales than what I usually deal with. In one of your slides, you had showed that you transfer the film from well, I think sapphire to silicon. And you have a feeling that that gets rid of some of the growth stresses.
Right.
How do you do this transfer?
So the typical process, which is still a dirty process in some ways, we tend to spin coat polymer on the film, and then we dip it in a sodium hydroxide solution. Mm-hmm. And in some cases, you can just use water as well, and that tends to go between the film and the substrate and peels it off. And then you can transfer it onto a silicon oxide film, and then you can remove the PMMA on the top just by using acetone and washing away the polymer.
I see. So now this film is bonded to the underlying silicon just by van der Waals forces?
That's what we think. Yeah, that's what we think. Okay. I mean, it's just sitting out there. So if you want to transfer it from there, you could again do the same. But yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
No, but what would be the size of this? This would be tiny, no?
So we can transfer the entire 2-inch wafer.
Oh, you can get the entire 2-inch wafer?
Yeah.
We can That is splendid.
So Tanu, in the chat box, Adit and Arun Pandey, he says nice presentation and talk, but here's a question: why large spin orbit coupling observed in 2D materials? What is the origin?
As far as I understand, and I'm sure there are experts sitting in the panel out here itself, but as far as I understand, it's because of the transition metal that is there and the d orbital of the transition metal that causes the spin orbital coupling to be so prominent in these materials. That would be my answer. The transition metal itself is causing the spin orbital coupling and splitting the bonds.
And Karthik says, here's a question. Karthik, you can go ahead, unmute yourself and ask.
Yeah, thanks. Nice talk, Tanushree. I didn't quite follow it all, but that's probably because I'm materially challenged. So when you visited our department, so you mentioned that you were interested in AFM technology, right? So I had a question that one of your slides had this sort of laid out grid of AFM images.
Mm-hmm.
So was that, I didn't quite follow, is that from an actual wafer?
Yes, it's from an actual wafer. Yep.
Could you perhaps go back to it?
Sure. Oh, sorry, wait, wrong the other way. Yeah, this is from an actual
wafer. Yeah, exactly. So is that an actual wafer then?
Yeah, that's an actual wafer which we scribed on the back before growing it. So if you wanted, we could break it after the growth so that we could take out 1 centimeter pieces without, damaging the film in any way.
Okay. So as I understand, these are for different, these are samples at different time durations during the process. Is that right?
No, so out here, this is one wafer which has gone through the same process throughout. What we are having out here is that images at different sections of this particular. So if you look at these square domains, these images were taken at different positions in the square domains. So it just shows the morphology at different parts of the wafer.
Okay. I was under the impression these are a different time instance, which is why I was wondering.
This one is one.
If you,
right. This is just one.
So, okay. And also, do people actually do experiments? So pardon me if this is a very naive question, but do people actually do experiments of in situ at different time durations?
So that would be perfect. If in case we could, that would be great just to know what really is happening, because all of it that we are doing is all ex situ stuff so far. So
yeah,
I don't think there is a whole lot that is being done so far from that perspective yet on it. But then, there's a lot of effort going on to figure out if there's a way to study this in situ by using, let's say, reflectance, which can allow you to distinguish when the domains start forming. But then nothing super successful as of now. You have it for graphene on copper, but not really for when you're using a film like sapphire. You don't have a lot of reflectivity, so that could be problems.
Okay. And what sort of time durations are we talking about here? What time scale are we talking about?
In this particular case of tungsten sulfide, we get a coalesced film in around 10 to 12 minutes for lateral growth after having gone through the nucleation and ripening. And tungsten selenide, maybe like 40 minutes or so. So it depends upon the parameters you use, but then that's the typical scale that you would have.
Okay. And what sort of spatial resolution are you talking about here that you need from an image?
If in case you're talking about, so this particular one is a scale bar of 400 nanometers, right? So your domains are extremely tiny. They would be like 10 to 20 nanometers, which would be difficult to get the optical method anyhow. So if you wanted to get into this scale, then yeah, it'll be a problem. But then to distinguish between, let's say, a monolayer and a bilayer, for example, this, you could still get that information in terms of where the bilayer begins to start growing out from optical methods itself. So there the scales would be a lot larger.
And what sort of temperatures are we talking about here?
Well, these are most of them, like this is done at 800, but most of the growths that we do right now at 1000 degrees C.
Okay. Centigrade or Fahrenheit, that makes a difference?
Centigrade. 1000 degrees centigrade.
Okay.
We try to follow the SI units as much as we can, even though, you know, US is...
No, as an AFM developer, if you will, yeah, that matters. You know, whether you need to operate at 700 degrees C or 1000, so yeah.
Okay.
So that's probably outside a temperature range. That's, I think, the biggest problem. Right. Otherwise, it could be done in situ.
What is the temperature you would typically do it at then?
No, I don't want my cantilever to melt and my electronics to melt, right?
I there are efforts at growing these films at lower temperatures, which obviously would be ideal because 1000 degrees C is obviously a very, very high temperature. But these films were done at 1000. But yeah, there are efforts underway which would hopefully reduce the temperature of growth.
So what temperature range would those be at?
You can have it as low as 550 degrees C or 450 degrees C. Some efforts at 450 degrees C as well, so that it can be integrated with other electronics. But I don't think I've seen anything lower than that.
Okay. So anyway, interesting discussion, but I would rather we can discuss offline rather than hijack this particular talk. But yeah, nice talk anyway. Thank you.
Okay. There are any more questions or clarifications?
Yeah, Ramani.
Yes, Professor Ramani.
I had just a semantic kind of a situation. No, we are all the magnetic guys. We get worried when we say transition metal, we look only at 3D. Now yours is all 4D and 5D. So that is the why I just was looking. Hey, there is no transition metal here. For me, you know, I was stuck with 3D, you know. Okay, that's all. I just wanted to ask why you are not being specific about 4D, 5D. Because in 3D you will not get so much of spin orbit coupling. This is the other issue that I wanted to point out. There could be a fair amount of screening here the moment you go to the 4D and 5D.
Okay.
So that is why I was just trying to ask a semantic kind of thing. Okay. Yeah, thanks. Sorry, this is only semantics.
No, but this is good to know because I also would like to know a little more about spin orbital coupling myself. But I think the thing is that we kind of take that whole block as transition metal because you can ideally, you know, make things from 3D, 4D, 5D. So we just switch it with the entire name itself, but then you're right, we don't distinguish between 3D and 4D because...
3D, definitely the spin orbit quenching is much higher.
Okay.
That's all.
But you don't use this. So in this particular case, having a larger spin orbital coupling is better. Like tungsten selenide has the separation that you have in the valence band is around 150 millielectron volt.
I'm quite sure as a 2D material, you would want all of these kind of features because you would want to use them for, say, some kind of a spintronic or any of the other type of modern day solid state materials that people are all talking about, in which case you need to control the spin orbit coupling more. Yeah, that, I mean, so if that is the only manner I was looking at. Yeah, thanks.
Thank you.
Then there is also a question from Aditya Narayan Pandey. Why not telluride use?
Tellurides. We are like, okay, there is work going on in tellurides. MOCVD is like a sad process so far. So if you look at the precursors we use, hydrogen sulfide, hydrogen selenide, very, very dangerous, you know, all that stuff. But you can use organic telluride sources for getting these films, but then using that, I don't think we have achieved any monolayer growth so far. You can grow thick layers, which has multiple domains, you know, in-plane, out-of-plane growth, and usually those are limited to 400 degrees C. So the domain sizes are also lesser. But yes, you can do tellurides, and for that, MV is a better process in terms of the fluxes they can control and, you know, what they can do with the telluride precursor in terms of using a cracker and stuff. The MOCVD doesn't seem like a very promising method for tellurides as of now.
Okay. Any other questions or clarification?
I think Vaishali has raised a hand.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Go ahead, Vaishali.
Tanushree, this is a very interesting topic from my own research perspective. I have two questions. One is related with more like semantics. When you say monolayer, you mean, what do you really mean here? Because you're not completely covering the sapphire surface during your growth. And similarly for a bilayer, I would like to know what you mean by how do you differentiate here?
So what we're trying to do is, of course, cover the entire sapphire substrate with a layer of tungsten selenide itself. That's what we want to do. So ideally, this particular thing that you have here, this is a monolayer that covers all the layers. Now, we're trying to create situations that these tiny holes that you have here, which is a sapphire substrate, also don't remain. But while you're trying to fill this up, you can start forming these bilayer domains that form. So we have a pretty large coalesced surface of like 99% monolayer, and then you start forming small percentage of bilayers on top. So that's what I mean by a monolayer. So there are, of course, some holes which will be left behind. We see that in the TEM. I don't know whether it actually was during the growth or whether there's an etching that's happening during the transfer that's causing it. But let's go with the fact that the entire growth doesn't entirely happen. So there are small holes, let's say, which are left behind. But what the aim is to try and grow this over the entire wafer itself. So you get a coalesced monolayer film on the wafer, and that they might have some bilayer regions, which we are trying to see how to make.
Okay. The other question I have is, see, you showed this picture where your this triangular growth happens away from the step edges.
Okay.
So have you looked at, I don't know, are you aware of anybody who has done any theoretical work to look at these step edge barriers? Because typically, when you look at this kind of growth, when you have a material being deposited on another material, and if you look at what the atomic mechanisms that are happening when the atoms diffuse on surfaces during growth, it is known that they experience a barrier at the step edges.
Yeah, the Irwin-Schoebel barrier. We thought it
was
that.
Yes.
But if that is the case, then that is a barrier I would expect to be there for any kind of step edge, right? It would be there for any kind of a step edge, which would mean
the mechanism
would be the other way, right? You know, it's not starting from the step edge itself, it's starting the other way, what we see. So we thought it is that. I don't know if that is what is active out here. So we are trying to see a little more, understand exactly what's going on, because that is the first thing that came to our mind, that maybe that's the barrier because of which it's not able to get off the terrace edge, and that's why it gets trapped out there. But I don't know if that's what is happening.
Okay.
Anybody else?
I had one more question if everybody else is done.
You can go ahead.
This is Karthik again. So, towards the end of your talk, you had a device which had multiple layers, as I recall.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Is that fabricated using a standard MEMS process with mask, etc.?
Yeah. It's a standard lithography process.
Okay. And again, what sort of spatial resolution are you talking about?
So these devices, the contacts were, I think the channel length was 5 micron. So we had multiple different ranges or different sizes as well. But the one that I'm talking about is 5 micron, is the distance between the contacts itself. So that is the lateral dimension. But you can go down lower if you want to. But yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Professor Ramani.
Sorry. What happened, that last question that Karthik asked, again, got me to ask this question. So you're looking at 5 micron devices. These are fairly large. And your CVD growth, if you take a look at your AFM pictures and so on and so forth, the defects are fairly random. So you would have a reasonably statistical variation with the devices. So what is the final objective in terms of the defect control that you would like in such systems? I mean, do you have a engineering number in place? Because if you are going targeting towards actually, you said you are looking at wafer scale CVD. Yep. So what is the target that you must have? Because it's really tough. I know one is looking at all these numbers and looking at the pictures. Right. It's really very, very difficult processing you do. And so what would you finally be happy with?
That's a very good question. Like a wonderful question. So let's see. So thing is, I mean, of course, I would like to say, you know, you're able to replace silicon itself, which I think we have accepted that that's not something that you can do. It can be something that can augment whatever properties are there. It can be used for doing something like low power sensors, which can be used for IoTs, for example. But what is the defect density we are looking at? That's a difficult question to answer, because for the TMDs, there are multiple factors coming, which is not just the growth. We focused on trying to see if we could reduce the line defects. But that is not to say that we don't have any points defects present in our films. That is definitely present. We do see arrays of sulfur defects or selenium defects present in our films. That is there, which is a vestige of the growth itself. But then you undergo a process of transfer. When you are assembling the entire material, it's going to see contacts are a problem. You have a detector that has to sit on it. That formation itself is a problem. So if you're talking about what is the final device I would want it to be, there are too many parameters which are still unexplored or don't have perfect answers. So I don't have a number as to what we are looking for in terms of defect density. We looked at just one aspect, and I don't think that's one part of it. But there are so many other parts which can right now, which I think are more important to solve if in case you really want to get the most out of these TMEs itself. So that is my answer. Like, I don't have an answer of what is the kind of defect density we are looking at, or what is the final output you would want out of it, because I think there are too many things in motion which I don't have proper answers for yet.
Yeah, but you are convinced that this is where you will be spending your lifetime.
I have convinced myself this is where I'll be spending my lifetime.
Yeah, because
by identifying the other things that I want to do.
It's a very, very, very challenging task, you know?
Yes. So yes, I wish there is a more clear answer. Hopefully a little more work in this. Okay, hopefully a lot more work in this direction after I get the lab. And you know, and stuff, hopefully I make a proper answer. Like, maybe you get to meet in 5 years' time and I tell you this is the number I want. I would think that is success.
5 years is too long for me. I'm not around.
Then send me a telegram, Professor Ramya. Send you a telegram. Yeah.
No problem. What you're trying to do and what you're trying to aim at, very, very tough kind of situations. And there's a fair amount of statistical problems that you have to overcome.
Yep.
So that is what I'm, really looking at.
Yep. I agree. We are looking at a very, very small, tiny part of the problem. It's definitely not going to solve everything else. It's just one very, very small sliver. And it might work out that it doesn't even matter.
Then the question is, the payoff must be that big, no? For you to put that kind of a line.
Correct. But I am interested in it just from the fact of it that I honestly, okay. Maybe I should be saying this on while we are being recorded. I care about why the films grow out the way they do. So for that, the payoff is good enough.
Okay.
If in case we can get anything out of it, hopefully we do. Otherwise, it will be a wasted effort. But I think there is potential still.
No, fine, great. Then in which case, why not do a lot more controlled experiments rather than trying to say, I would do wafer scale kind of a stuff. You know, if it is academic and if it is entirely, to satisfy certain basic sciences kind of thing, why put yourself to that kind of a trouble?
Well, the project that we're working on. So the thing is that we've been able to get wafer scale because we were doing the mechanism part of it as well. I don't think that the wafer scale is something that is just, separated from whatever you're trying to do from the mechanics part of it, right? If you're able to control the mechanics of it on 1 centimeter, you should actually be able to control it on 4 inches or 10 inches.
There I will again butt in and say, hey, your AFM thing itself shows there is a fair amount of distribution on the CVD deposition. That is what you had, no? That bilayer ones higher in the center. So I was concerned that you still have some kind of a mass transfer related problem there. You know, and you're also at a fairly high temperature and you were trying to do fairly weak, components to get it. So, anyway, you have a lot of moving parts. So, good, great, best of luck for you. Yeah.
Thank you for giving me these mini suggestions. I'll look into it.
Sorry?
Thank you for the suggestions. I'll think about all of these more.
Yeah, thanks. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Okay. If there are no more questions, and if there are, then yeah, I'm sure Tanushree can take it offline. There are several participants who appreciated, even in the chat box, that the talk was great. And yes, I agree, Tanu, it was a very beautifully put together talk. And you were on time, but also very detailed. And also, thank you for patiently answering all the questions. I'm sure everybody knows where to contact you. But so, like I said, she is at IIT Bombay as an assistant professor now. So you'll find her email ID on our webpage. So feel free to write to her for any other feedback.
You have included my email ID, I didn't. But then, yeah.
You can maybe just paste it in the chat box for people who are still around. Yeah.
Yeah, it is part of the poster, so it is there.
Oh, yes.
I made it part of the poster. So.
All right. Yeah, so I think we are done for today. And thank you once again to everyone who made it, even though there was a last minute change in the link and so on.
Hey, but now the link works and somebody was waiting at the MIT phase.
Oh, no.
One person.
Okay, that's not too bad.
Yeah, but they will have the recording, so we are still good.
Right. Yes.
And it's nice to see so many and the nice participation. So I'm really glad. And thanks a lot, Tanushree.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
No, it was very good. I think I didn't put in the chat box, but I enjoyed the talk.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Okay.
All right.
Good. So I'm going to close the meeting and end for all, but we will continue the conversation. So,
all right. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Yeah, hi Tanushree, nice talk.
Oh, hi, yeah, thanks.
If you plan to use the CN facility,